sort of a state of the world video here, because we have September 24, 25 coming up, Feast of Trumpets, U.S. President chairing the Security Council, a resolution towards ISIS, and what we're headed towards is this collapse of our attention. Attention on high, attention that is looking for truth. We're going to have a collapse, a collective collapse in the world, the worst collapse ever, actually. As far as our attention goes, our attention is going to be diverted away from spiritual aspiration. That's because much of the aspiration spiritually in the world is dualistic, and it's set up to fail. Remember, this world is a place where those whose attention wants to be on failure, this is where they come. So you, spirit, as spirit, have attention. And when you want your attention to be on failure, to recognize reality, this world, this collective hallucination we call the world, is one of the places that your attention will lead you to. And in this world, the teachings are mostly dualistic, spiritually dualistic. They're designed to fail. So what's going to happen is a lot of the spiritual teaching in the world, a lot of the traditions, religions, they're going to collapse. Our attention is going to collapse away from all of that. And people will be looking around and feel confused. Their attention will feel fragmented, and they will not be able to put their attention up onto, you know, to the true non-dual teachings, actually. Non-dual teachings. What we're doing here is non-dual spiritual teaching. So again, this is a play of attention. Some say play of consciousness. We'll use the word attention, play of attention in this world. This is the game that's being played. It's a struggle between failure and success. Keep in mind, the root of our trouble is we took a stance of hallucination, of hallucinating. And we then believed that what we were hallucinating was real. That meant what we were experiencing before we hallucinated must be a hallucination. So we took ourselves then to be unreal. The hallucinator, we think, oh, I'm unreal. And then we thought, how do I get reality? Oh, from what I am hallucinating. I must be a product of that. Okay, so we believe we're a product of nature. And we believe we must keep this belief. If we don't, we believe we'll vanish. If what we're hallucinating vanishes, we believe we will vanish. So we're trying to desperately fail to set down this stance of hallucination. And of course we took the stance of hallucination, misinterpretation, when we wanted to try to be greater than God. We tried to change reality. We tried to see reality different than what it really is, and then claiming that seeing it differently means that we somehow changed it. But all we did was misinterpret it. We did not change reality. We misinterpreted it. This misinterpretation is called an hallucination, the stance of hallucination. So we are looking at our misinterpretation, believing it to be real, and believing reality to be a misinterpretation, a mere hallucination. So we're afraid to set down our misinterpretation, thinking that we are a product of that. That's where we get our identity. So most are dedicated to failing to set that down, failing, failure is success is the motto of this world. So we're about to enter into an age of failure, a new age of failure, of great failure, of great spiritual dualism. And of course we'll label it a great success. We'll label it a golden age, a great success. We finally turned all our attention away from the non-dual truth, and we've got it on dualistic confusion, and we believe that is success. So there is this time that is upon us now where our attention is likely to become very much pulled down and confused as this relativism, this dualism, this failure will become all the rage in lack of due process, accusations, blame, projection, all the dynamics of this failure will be boiling everywhere. The irrational will take over. The dynamics of fear will be in control. And the dynamics of fear are that because we're terrified of letting go of the stance of hallucination, we feel that this great good news within us, that is, we're not, reality is not a hallucination, it's real. And nothing has ever happened, there hasn't been any leaving or separation at all. We're terrified of this, and we don't want to be attracted to it. And yet at the same hand, we're desperate to find happiness within this hallucination, so that we don't drop the hallucination. Okay, so we end up then expecting the hallucination to make us happy, and it doesn't. And so we get very angry at this, and we blame others for not making us happy. We blame the world. We feel the world is dangerous in that it's not helping us enough. And all of this anger and fear and projection and blame builds up and builds up, builds up, builds up, builds up in the world. This is the price we pay. This we call it hell. The price we pay, the wages of sin is death. We say the wages of sin is abiding in this hellish situation of fear and failure and blaming others for not making us happy, being terrified of our own happiness within us, feeling that others' responsibility is to protect us from ourselves. So we're going to go into this massive collapse of attention. Our attention is going to collapse off of spiritual aspiration. And we're going to be pulled down by all of the details of materiality, this sort of life. The constant cycling. I need to trade my phone in every year. I need to constantly keep up with technology and all the constant changes and contracts and plans and versions and updates and changes in laws. And we'll become obsessed with all of this mundane confusion and difficulty. And we will forget to put our attention up to the heights of aspiration, which is actually the capacity to abide in the vision of oneness, which frees us from the stance of hallucination, frees us from all continuity fear. This world here is nothing but the expression of our continuity fear. And so, I would say that September 24th and 25th, this Feast of Trumpets, is a very significant time, and it signals For me, it signals that we're moving into this shift of attention. Now, you see, we've been looking up to various institutions and teachings for a long time. We've been looking up to them. But we've set our sights too low. But I call this phase one. It's very important to realize that in this plan of saving us from continuity fear and failure, there are five phases, really. And most of us have been trying to get into phase one, struggling with phase one. A lot of here have not even gotten into phase one. They've not even started. But those who have started have been struggling with phase one for a long time. And they're still struggling, which means their sights, let's say a spiritual aspiration, these phases was like a great big mountain, high mountain. They have their sights set up on just the mountainside, a little ways up. Okay, that's what they've been looking at. They've not been looking any higher. Not yet. Phase two, you look higher. And then you see, wow, there's a mountain there. Phase three, your sights are set up high up on the mountain. Like, I think I can get to, I can see the top of the mountain. I can see the whole mountain in the top. Phase four is, your attention is just on the top, really. It's all on the top saying, I can reach the top. I'm looking at it very carefully. Phase five, you've reached the top of the mountain. So what we have in the world now is a lot of people who have at least repented and started in phase one. They're still looking at the lower part of the mountain, and they think that's it. Well, it's the lower part of the mountain that is going to collapse. A lot of it. And that is what's going to throw people into turmoil. Those who have their eyes set on the peak, that doesn't collapse. So what we're doing phase four here, we're getting our attention on the peak. Okay, this is the peak transmission. This is transmission of the peak. You don't want to keep your attention lower on the mountain right now, because all of that has been been a trick. There have been a lot of dualistic teachings, like, patched in to the side of a mountain. Intentionally, they're going to suddenly collapse. A lot of this is going to collapse. And those who have their attention only there are going to feel like, oh my gosh, it's all collapsing. The mountain's collapsing. It's not. The mountain is not collapsing. It is just that they put up this fake wall on the lower part of the mountain and then are going to collapse that, and trying to throw you into spiritual turmoil. But the peak is not collapsing at all. Nothing's happening to the peak. So that's why it's very important to get into phase two, three, and four during these times. There's been a big push for that. And I'm part of that. I've been part of that big push, as have many around the world. You cannot just stay floundering in the first phase forever. Man cannot always wander beneath the palms, right? We have to, our aspirations have to go higher. For example, phase one struggles very badly with, because they're coming out of tremendous belief in failure, and so they're trying to now reconcile success and failure, and they're trying to please both. So you get something like Jesus saying, I am the truth, the way, and the life. Now, before he left, Simon Peter said, where are you going? And Jesus says, where I'm going, you cannot go yet. You cannot go now, but later you'll be able to. And Simon Peter, of course, said, no, I'll go wherever you go. He said, no, you'll renounce me three times, right, in the morning. And then he said, look, I'm going in my Father's home, there are many rooms. I'm going to go prepare a place for you. Come back and take you to that place that I prepared for you. And he did say, you know, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now, here's the problem with the statement for phase oneers. They constantly put, I am the way, I am the way. And they're thinking, I am the way. They're taking it like a personal viewpoint is stating this, that my personal viewpoint, I, with this personal viewpoint, am the way. Okay, but gradually in phase two, three, and four, you realize the emphasis, this is how it says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Leaving out the is for dramatic purposes, it's really saying, I am, is the way, the truth, and the life. But for emphasis, dramatic emphasis, just saying, I am the way, the truth, and the life. In other words, I am is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is talking from the standpoint of I am-ness, the totality-ness. I am everywhere-ness, just the one I am-ness. There's only one all-embracing, super-saturating I am-ness. So he's saying I am-ness is the way, the truth, and the life. And so this is understood. He's speaking from the transcendent totality viewpoint. Jesus was not speaking from the personal viewpoint. And the problem is in phase one is we're so used to the personal needing to triumph, getting out of this pit. We take everything personally. And we say, well, Jesus was talking personally about himself, just like I'm talking about myself. And no, it is impersonal. It's the impersonal I am. It's the all-ness speaking. It's God speaking, you see. God is the I am-ness, the great all-present everywhereness of I am-ness. Saying, so God is saying, I am is the way, the truth, and the life. So those in phase one are, you know, they get half right and half wrong, and then try to, you know, all lots of sorts of different ways to be happy with this, you know, with this amalgamation, which isn't the answer. So Jesus is simply an expression of I am-ness, the totality, the impersonal totality coming here to speak to those who have tried to fail to accept this for a long time. So in their failure to accept this, of course, they're thinking that, no, I am just this person, I am this body, I am in this world, I am just a little, you know, and you are different. And of course there will be confusion. So phase one is you struggle with trying to make truth and lies both true. Okay, now before you even start phase one, you're not even trying to do that, you're just trying to make lies true. Yeah, you know, those who have not started are just simply trying to make lies true. In phase one, you're trying to make both lies and truth true. You see truth, and then you also used to lies, and say, how can I put those together? Phase two, you basically give up this attempt to make lies and truth true. And you say, only truth is true. Only truth is true. Nothing else is true. And then it's like, wow. You mean I've got to get to the top of that mountain? Wow, yeah, that's a high mountain. And then phase three is you start really climbing up higher on the mountain. You get high up on the mountain. And then phase four is you reach the top. And then phase five is how do you feel from the top of the mountain? You see, you're abiding in the vision of oneness. You see everything is all one. So you have, and the ones that have not started, yet they insist that lies are true, that failure is what we really want. And the ones that at phase one are like saying, wait a minute, no, we have a way to deal with the lies, you know, and we have a way to combine things here. We have something better than you. And the others say, no, you don't. So there's a big conflict there. And we were told that the church age will come to an end. Well, the church age is phase one. Okay. We're told that the church age will come to an end at the end of this world cycle. Well, we're at the end of the world cycle. And the church age is coming to an end. Church age is only phase one. The church is just like a nursery. You're supposed to, from phase one, you're supposed to get into phase two, and phase three, and phase four. And you're supposed to get out of spiritual dualism. You're supposed to get out of good and bad, triumph and defeat, you know, victory and defeat. This idea that truth needs to destroy lies, you know, like that. No, lies are simply untrue. You just have to realize that there's no truth to them at all. You don't have to do anything to get rid of a lie except just accept truth. So the church age was a nursery, and we needed to grow into phase two, three, and four, and ultimately five. So the church age is going to be brought to an end. It's already, you can tell, it's being pulled down into irrelevancy. Very much irrelevancy. It's no longer functioning as a good nursery at all. And of course, they make an easy target for the unrepentant ones, because their theology and their beliefs are compromises. They're mixed up. They're trying to accommodate both truth and lies. So they don't really have the mental stability to deal with these unrepentant ones. They just shout and yell, get angry, and pray that there's some God somewhere that will come down and smite their enemies and destroy their enemies. Doesn't work that way. God is not a smiter of enemies. God doesn't see any enemies. Truth has no enemy. Truth has no opposite. Truth has no adversary whatsoever. So this is stage two, three, and four teaching. So a lot of people have come out of the nurseries of organized religion, whatever. There's various organized religions around the world. They're nurseries for like babies. And the babies have to grow up and crawl, walk, run, and be able to climb eventually and get up to the heights and eventually reach the peak. So this world cycle draws to an end. There won't be any place to take refuge in terms of this phase one, which has provided sort of a refuge for spiritual infants. That all is being sort of like folded back into the mix. There has to be a briskness. You have to grow spiritually. You know, you cannot just stagnate. You cannot just adopt, oh, okay, I'm phase one, and I'm going to impose all these beliefs on everybody and insist that these are true just because we have a little bit of truth. Half-truths are not really true. The idea that Jesus is going to come back leading a great army and is going to destroy everyone, all the enemies, you know, that's not true. One of the greatest mistruths is that, for example, in phase one, we still have a lot of continuity fear left. Severe, still very severe. We're terrified of this good news within us that nothing ever happened. And we're totally free and perfectly happy. And say, no, that's too much. I don't want that. That's way too much. Please, please, and stay away, Jesus. Don't come here. So we really don't want quote unquote Jesus, which means the realization of this good news, the acceptance of this good news. We don't want the impersonal, the I am-ness. We don't want it yet. We say, well, I'm not ready. Don't come yet. We feel if it does come, we're going to be annihilated. Because again, we think we're a product of what we're hallucinating. But we don't want to admit that. We want to say, no, I've got it. I'm saved. So if it's not me, we project it out on others and say, see, they're the ones. They're not saved. Now, this is very interesting how this works. We then say that, you know, all those, when Jesus comes back, all those who have not repented, who have not gotten right with truth, are going to be destroyed forever, annihilated. Okay. Because this is our fear that we're not ready. And if we were to accept truth, we feel we'd be annihilated because we think that we're a product of what we're hallucinating. And if we accept the truth that we're not hallucinating, or drop the hallucination altogether, none of it was true ever, we feel we would not be true either. So we're terrified of that. So you know the song, Wait a Little Longer, Please Jesus. There are so many wandering around in sin. Just another day, please Jesus. Another day to get my loved ones in. What people then say is that, you know what? If I don't get my family members in, my loved ones, and Jesus comes back, they're all going to be annihilated. Hellfire will annihilate them forever. And they say, that's so terrible, so awful. Jesus, they say, Jesus, you don't need to wait for my sake. I've got it. But you've got to wait for the sake of my relatives. Because if you come back, they're going to be annihilated. That's not fair, is it? So we've invented this notion that Jesus coming back means that those who accept Jesus will be saved, and those who have not repented are going to be annihilated forever. This gives us the perfect excuse to tell Jesus to wait. It's not right because my relatives, my loved ones, they're not ready. And if they come back, you're going to destroy them all. This is horrible for me. I can't handle that. So you got to wait another day, just a little longer. Please wait just a little longer. This is phase one, fear, talking. Phase two, three, and four is, come back anytime. So I'm fine with that. No one's going to be annihilated. Don't have to wait for my sake at all. Now, how does Jesus come back? I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I am is the way, the truth, and the life. What is the return of Jesus? I am the way, the truth, and the life. See, the return of the way, the return of the truth, the return of the life. Okay, the true life of I am. So, Jesus may return, maybe soon, Feast of Trumpets, a lot of people feel. But is he going to be on a white horse, come leading an army to destroy everyone that doesn't agree with him? Because remember, we're only suffering from a continuity fear. That's it. In fact, all of us are perfectly within the totality of the oneness right now. Perfect spiritual being. It's just that we've been hallucinating that we're not. So we have this continuity fear. We're afraid to drop it. But we're all immaculate being. You think Jesus hates immaculate being that we are? No. Jesus sees us all as the immaculate being that we are, the totality that we are. There's no anger or hatred towards anyone, only love towards everyone. Rightfully so. All of this foolishness is only from the continuity fear. Continuity fear makes idiots out of us all, fools, knuckleheads out of us all. But that has nothing to do with our true identity whatsoever. It's merely a temporary situation that will evaporate soon enough. So Jesus comes back as I am-ness comes back as what? The way, the truth, and the life. As the light of the world. So the way may be revealed to us. The truth may be revealed to us. The life of I am-ness may be revealed to us very soon. This may be a very strong transmission coming up. We don't need Jesus here physically in a body, so to speak, because he says, I am the I am. I am the I am-ness. There's only one I amness. All is the one I amness. No, I amness is the way, the truth, and the life. And so we may become aware of this I amness very soon. We may become aware of this I amness very soon. And realize that this I amness is the way, the truth, and the life. And understand that there's no one separate from it at all. There's no separation from it at all. And understand that the stance of hallucinating brings about this dreadful continuity fear of annihilation, dreadful continuity fear. Coming from, it brings up the fear that we'll be annihilated if we drop it. And then when we finally see that this isn't so, we're still very terrified of setting it down. Because the good news is too good for us. The success we feel is just off the charts, so much so we can't even relate to it in any way. Just the total I amness, yeah? The total non-dualness. We just feel like we can't handle it. Very severe continuity fear. Those in phase one have a lot of confusion trying to mix truth and lies together. And it's not a place you want to just hang out indefinitely, for sure. You want to really say, hey, you know, there's something, I need a great, clear explanation. Phase one is when you catch a glimpse of truth and then you say, wow, I know there's truth somewhere. And then you try and accommodate both truth and lies. And you think, well, the lies have to be destroyed. Something out there needs to be destroyed because they're not making me happy. That's still the old way, pre-repentance way, the pre-repentance way. Eye for an eye, tooth for tooth. And so this is the world. This is the world we live in. So what are we expecting? The I amness, this descent, this feeling of I amness. Just not I, not this body, but I amness. Super saturating everything, everywhere, everything. And then we get used to that, for that is the way and the truth and the life. So the way and the truth and the life may arise within us very soon, very soon. That's why I've been working so hard on these fourth phase exercises to helps us stabilize, help us get through this transitional time. I feel transitional time, it is arriving now. It is arriving. The prophetic books, there's a lot of talk about when a U.S. president assumes the head of the Security Council and leads a coalition, you know, a global coalition. It's really an attempt to establish a global coalition. And that is actually the trigger for this massive collapse of our attention into confusion. If we have our attention on the lower parts of the mountain instead of the higher parts of the mountain. So that's why I've said my whole life, guard your attention. And at all costs, strive to put your attention on as high as you can. Continuously, every day, get up there and look at that mountain and try to put your attention higher and higher and higher. It's all important because there is going to be this collapse, as it were, of our attention. But we have our attention on, it's going to seem to collapse and disintegrate. What we think is spiritual. Spirituality is going to let us down. It's going to fragment. It's going to be so. And if we have our attention there, we're going to be lost. We're truly going to be very confused. Our attention will be very confused. Where do I put my attention? Here? There? You know, so it's there. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. Very bad situation. So. That's why at all costs, every day, put your attention as high as you can and try and avoid any attention elsewhere. And I've been, you know, trying to walk that walk. These days, I, you know, cut off the news, cut off just about everything. I'll watch a few innings of a baseball game, and the rest of the time, it's on as high as I can, attention as high as I can. It's absolutely necessary. Because not everyone in phase one necessarily makes it to phase two. If they take phase one to be the end all and be all, they most certainly won't make it. But you do see, for example, like in Christianity, you do see a lot of Christians saying, hey, wait a minute, this Old Testament God of hatred and fear and anger and viciousness and punishment, killing our enemies and smiting us if we don't do it, we say, and all this stuff. He said that, you know, that can't be the true God, right? It can't be. The true God must be a God of love, as Jesus said, God of forgiveness. And so they're going more into phase two-ness, okay, in various ways. For example, A Course in Miracles is a phase two teaching. And that, but not everyone goes into that. There's other ways to go into phase two. But the phase two teaching has to be very intense. And to get to phase three, to really handle phase three. Where phase three, there's no wiggle room. There's no more wiggle room. And then phase four is just a full-on climb to the top. Zero wiggle room is a given. You're not even thinking about that. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. So there's never been a pit. There's never been layers and levels. What we're hallucinating has never been. The way that we see, we're seeing our belief system that we're projecting upon reality has not affected reality in the slightest bit, and never will. Nobody is going to be lost. All will have their continuity problem eventually evaporated. Everyone has exactly the same problem. You know, it's just this totality, these totalistic statements, these completely abstract statements without any dualism whatsoever to them. We're very used to that, and it's not our slightest problem. So we may be on the verge of a great arising of I am-ness. Now, there are those who have spoken of a shift in consciousness on this planet. It's a shift of attention. This is possible. This is actually possible. This is called the separation of the wheat from the chaff, or the wheat from the tares, the wheat from the weeds, the sheep from the goats. That there is going to be a time where those who can go with this I am-ness, this non-dualness, they will be able to accept this, and then there are those who will not be able to accept it, and then this will be a dividing point here in this world. There are also those who believe that this shift in attention of the world will affect everybody on the planet will get it. That's like a idealistic pipe dream. We're pragmatically, the continuity fear is the dynamic in charge. And you simply don't get around the continuity fear at all through some sort of magical solution where, because I have changed, you must change. Enough people change, we all have to change. Now, those with a very severe continuity fear are not going to just, it's an issue of familiarity. You just don't succeed instantly with an issue of familiarity. It's not possible. So that's a spiritually idealistic, spiritually intellectual notion that somehow we're all going to be. That's kind of like a high phase one attitude. They're basically saying, we don't want to go any higher than phase one, we're scared. You get into phase two and you start to recognize just how severe the fear is here and what it's based on. And then you realize it's based on something very deep. And you just don't deal with that superficially. It has to be dealt with on a very deep basis. It has to be gradually evaporated. A lot of patience, a lot of support. It's not something you just yank them up and say, okay, you're safe now. It could make things worse. So this phase, various phases of nurseries, that continues on and on and on and on and on until everybody eventually is safe. There's no magical solution to this. So it's graduation time. You complete 4 years of high school, 4 years of college. It's time to graduate. And those who are, you know, still just freshmen, they're not ready to graduate. Some juniors graduate early. They've been really pushing things, right? And they've done the third and the fourth phase, even though they may seem to not have taken as much time, even some sophomores. And I guess a rare instance, you might even have some genius freshmen or something. But by and large, those who have, you know, reached the fourth phase in through one, two, three, four phases, they're ready to graduate. So the larger cycles and goings on are really pretty amazing. The future of this world might be very different than what people expect. But the bottom line is your attention. So always it comes back to attention. Where is our attention? Is it on dualism or non-dualism? Non-dualism is that we know, nothing is wrong, everything is perfect. No one has fallen into a pit, no one's left reality. Nothing has happened at all to reality. Everything is still perfect with reality. We're still perfect. Everyone is still perfect. And so this is a blissful condition, happy condition, joyful condition. An unconcerned, carefree condition. That there's nothing anyone can imagine they can do that is going to change reality in the slightest bit. So it's a supremely optimistic condition based on fact. And that's phase five. That's phase five. So in phase four, we practice this. We practice non-dualistic techniques. We practice how wonderful the news is going to be, how wonderful it's going to feel. So it's very positive type of practices in phase four. You just feel the whole universe is just ecstatically perfect right now. Absolutely no trouble anywhere. Everything is immaculate, absolutely immaculate. It's the immaculateness of immaculateness. It's so immaculate, it's immaculate, free immaculateness. It's even beyond anything we can say, right? Pure spaciousness is never affected by anything that arises in it. The totality is never affected by anything that any arising or not arising. So the struggle for attention, I've been working with this my whole life, trying to help, and it's very difficult to help out in the world. We all have a great difficulty with our attention. There's no question about it. Because it's a constant issue in everyone's life. Constant issue. You get 5 minutes to some sort of spiritual exercise and the rest of the day to where failure wants your attention, that's not going to help very much. So you almost have to keep a constant determination going on within you. And one of the ways, a lot of different ways to practice, one of them is to look at any thought that arises and say, is this the vision of oneness? If not this, then this thought has absolutely no value to me. And then just drop it. And just watch your thoughts, whatever arises, say, is this the vision of oneness? Oh, it's not? Then this thought has absolutely zero value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. This is how I reached the vision of oneness, actually, was by watching every thought that arose in my mind and in quickly as possible asking, is this the vision of oneness? And then if it wasn't, I said, stopped it right there. This thought has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And in doing this practice, the vision of oneness dawned. So this actually works. But no one can do it for you. You have to do it for yourself, is the whole thing. You can get some practice and encouragement to do it, but ultimately you have to watch your own thoughts and whatever comes up. Is this the vision of oneness? Oh, is this thought about this a vision of oneness? Is this it? Oh, it's not it? Then this has absolutely no value. Get out of here. I have no interest in you. You have no value to me whatsoever. And be very insistent upon it. You know, leave me. Get out. I have no interest in you, this thought. Thoughts try to take you here. What it really means is your attention is getting pulled here, is getting pulled there. What it really means is your continuity fear is saying, hey, attention, why don't you turn your attention over there? And then you project thoughts and you think, oh, the thoughts are calling to me. No, we're projecting those thoughts. Thoughts are projections. This, you know, imagination, interest of our attention is, oh, look at that thought there. And it puts it, no. First, we had this continuity fear. Then the continuity fear says, I've got to fail. I've got to fail. I don't want my attention going to this non-dual teaching. So, okay, I'm going to project happiness out there and project thoughts that are marketing the happiness, saying, come check this out. And so then say, okay, attention, look here. Oh, attention sees these thoughts that are saying, hey, you know, why don't you do this? Why don't you come this way? And if you entertain those thoughts, there you go, and you're lost in some scenarios of failure. So what you need to do is this, it's like those guys in the Ginza district of Tokyo. And there's all these nightclubs, and they all have these guys go, the yobikomis outside. Irashitaimasen, come on in, irashitai, dozo, you know. They're all dressed up and hyperactive and doing all these funny things, you know, attention grabbers. Trying to grab your attention. And they're saying, come on in here, you know, you have a lot of fun in here. Come on in the bar, come on in. You know, these guys, you know, and so this is what they do. And they seem very personable. Like the most wonderful outgoing, saying you're just gonna feel like me if you go in this bar. You're gonna be like me, just, you know, elated. Come on in, irashaimasen, dozo. And you say, wow, maybe this is the answer. Maybe this is how I'm going to be so freed up and elated and all this. You know? But these guys are professional marketers, you see. And so our thoughts are like this. Our thoughts are like these marketers, see. Pay attention. Come on in this market. Come on into this market and browse this market. We got a lot of great stuff for you. So we have to first, you have to say, hey, take a hard line. Hey, is this thought the vision of oneness? Is this thought the vision of oneness? I want to know. Oh, it's not? Then I have absolutely no interest in you or anything you're saying. You have zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. That's it. No more attention on you, and you pull your attention off of it. This is the direct practice, actually, a very direct practice. Well, it's very direct. It's not completely direct because we're just getting our attention off of other stuff, but it's very, very powerful, pulling our attention right back to vision of oneness. The vision of oneness kind of just dawns upon us when our attention is freed up. I don't know if we can like make a vision of oneness an object of our attention. You see, I think that interferes with it. Because it seems like a thought then that's marketing itself or something. And we're trying to market it to ourselves. I think it's better neti, not this. Free our attention up. As our attention frees up, we're no longer afraid of the spaciousness of it, and it just intrinsically, organically dawns upon us this vision of oneness. Just, oh, this is it. Okay. This is where my attention naturally rests. It's already there. It's never left. It's just that we've been looking at this make-believe, like a dream, but our attention is really always abiding in the oneness. But we can imagine that it's not. So we cannot keep entertaining this hallucination, this continuity fear, this desire for failure, and know where we really are, know where our attention truly, naturally abides. How to keep our attention there. This is as soon as, it seems like as soon as we try to, it vanishes. So I would say we should just simply act like we've been there. That's it, yeah. And just stay quiet. It's like a veteran baseball player hits a home run. They just trot around the bases and it's no big deal. That's what I do. You get some rookie first time, it was incredible. Wow. How did I do that? I can't believe I did that. It's amazing. Start thinking. Whereas the veteran is not thinking at all. It's just saying, man, this just happens. This is what I do. This is what my profession is. I know how to do this. This is what I do. So just another. Just another home run, no big deal at all. No thinking at all. So we may have the opportunity to shift into the non-dual awareness here coming up. There may be a big boost for the world. It's very, very likely, actually. I would expect there will be, actually, because there's going to be a huge collapse in this world, too. So there needs to be also a big boost. And we just have to, you know, say, yeah, I've been here before. we've been working on this, and so now it's time to just, you know, stay here, and that's fine. Time to stay here. In fact, beyond that, we realize that there's no way we cannot stay here. So staying here is the realization there's no choice but to stay here. And so this is what gets us jittery. We say, wait a minute. And how did I get here? You know, how did I arrive? How did I depart? There was no arrival, no departure. Now, as we're abiding in this non-dual awareness, we will see the rest of the world, the struggle going on, and those who think that they're the forces of light and they're defeating the forces of darkness will feel that like some awesome situation is taking place. But they're misinterpreting it, actually. The awesomeness is that the realization that nothing is taking place. So they're missing the awesomeness of it. And kind of like a play, a very dramatic play, you know, our attention might get pulled into that. This is what I experienced when I was dwelling in the non-dual absolute, is I saw this fight between the darkness and the light, and many of the lights escaping the darkness. There's all these escape from the darkness. And it's very dramatic, and so many people are so into this. It's like super important. I was saying, like, how do I talk to those people who feel this way? I didn't really know what to say to them. What to say about this. So I've been working on that for quite a couple months now. Still seem to be not quite sure what to say. But I may be able to get it here. I feel like I need to get this very, very soon here, before the 24th of September. What is today? The 21st is the first. Was it the first day of autumn today? Right? Wow, something like that. Yeah. Here comes the fall. Here comes the fall. More ways than one. So out of this fall will be those who insist that you know, that they're half-truths. They deserve to rule. They deserve to dominate. And others will say, no, they deserve not to dominate. There's all this turmoil. So I feel we have to have the right perspective on this very soon. So I will continue working on this. Still, I feel coming up a little short here, but maybe a concentrated effort will suffice. Be a very welcome breakthrough for sure, right in the nick of time. Okay, very great. That's it.